And then during the middle part of that hour, we're going to bring in Alex Jones. He, too, infiltrated the Bohemian Grove as well. We'll get his take on some of these strange things that continue to go on our planet. Back in a moment on Coast to Coast AM. Our guest is John Ronson right here on Coast to Coast AM. John, you're also a best-selling author. Your book, Them, Adventures with Extremists. How did you get involved in this very strange type of research that you've been doing?
There was a guy living up the road from me called Sheikh Omar Bakri Mohammed, who's Britain's most notorious Islamic cleric. Well, they just kicked him out, actually. Called the 9/11 hijackers.
Okay, yeah, that was him. Same one. Okay.
Yeah, same guy. And I spent a year with Omar Bakri back in 97, filming a documentary about his life. Really, I just thought it was funny. I mean, at the time, don't now, but at the time I thought it was funny that here was a guy living among us who said he wanted to see the black flag of Islam flying over Downing Street. So I figured, you know, he lives down the road from me. He's going to need to use our symbols to destroy them. So I followed him around for a year. He was buying, you know, collection boxes for Hamas, and the only collection boxes they had were large plastic novelty Coca-Cola bottles and so on. And it was kind of like a carry-on movie, Omar's jihad campaign.
Did he know you were following him?
Yeah. He didn't know I was Jewish, although he outed me. He took me to his jihad training camp, which was near Gatwick Airport in a little scout hut, and he suddenly announced to the crowd, look at me with an infidel, look at me with John, who is a Jew. And they all went, in the middle of nowhere, which is not the best place to be outed as a Jew. But when I was with all these people, they all started telling me, they all started saying, did you know that there was a shadowy cabal secretly ruling the world from inside a secret room? And I said no. And I didn't really think about it. And then I made a documentary about the Klan in the Ozarks. This was the politically correct Klan run by a guy called Tom Robb, who wouldn't let his members use the N-word. And he kind of banned the robes and the hoods and, you know, the cross burnings. He kind of banned all the things that I guess were fun about being in the Ku Klux Klan. But his people all started saying the same thing. Did you know that there was a shadowy cabal ruling the world? So it suddenly dawned on me, you know, I bet none of these guys actually, you know, get on a plane and actually try and track down the shadowy cabal. There really is a secret room. Can you get in there? So I wrote this book, Them, Adventures with Extremists, in which I tried to find the secret room, and I got chased away by the Bilderbergers in Portugal.
And tell me, who are, in your mind, the Bilderbergers? Because we hear so much about that organization, of course, meeting at the Bilderberg Hotel, right?
Well, that's where they first met. We followed them to the Caesar Park Hotel in Sintra, Portugal, me and a guy called Big Jim Tucker from the American Free Press. It was the spotlight at the time. And we scouted around the hotel, pretending to be traveling salesmen. This was the day before these guys were supposed to arrive, who, by the way, I didn't believe existed at the time. I thought this was all, you know, this was just a paranoid fantasy. And as we left the hotel, we started getting followed by men in dark glasses, which completely terrified me. I mean, just totally freaked me out. I phoned at the British Embassy and explained to them that I was essentially a humorous journalist out of my depth. They phoned the Bilderbergers. And so the British Embassy called me back and said that the Bilderbergers said that nobody was following me. And I'm saying, you know, he's behind the tree. And so, you know, so suddenly I was really thrown into the deep end, being chased by shadowy henchmen in dark glasses.
Did you think they were going to do you in, John?
Yeah, I really handled it badly. Jim Tucker was loving it. You know, he was sort of blowing them kisses. And I was going, Jim, stop that. And I got very, you know, I got paranoid for a long time. You know, I was thinking that they were following me even when they weren't. I mean, eventually I got to meet some of the heads of the Bilderberg group, including Martin Taylor, who's the Secretary General, who's the CEO or has been the CEO of Barclays Bank and W.H. Smith. And
they're all wealthy people, aren't they, John?
Yeah, they're sort of wealthy centrist, mainly kind of centrist globalists. When I said to Dennis Healy, Lord Healy, who was one of the founding members, you know, is it fair to say that you were trying to create a world government? He sort of said, yeah, that's fair.
You're very nonchalant, right? Just boom, just spit it right out like that?
Yeah, yeah. Which surprised me, actually, because, of course, that's something that anti-Bilderbergers have always accused the Bilderberg of, you know, trying to create a one-world government. And Dennis Healy said, yep, yep, that's true. He said that, you know, post-Second World War, we needed to find a way to, you know, thwart future Hitlers. And the idea would be to take politics out of the hands of politicians and put it into the hands of, you know, industrialists and bankers. Take ideology out of politics. That seems to be the Bilderberg agenda.
Did he talk, John, it sounds like he was pretty free with you.
Yeah.
I don't know why.
Well, not that free. At one point I asked if, he's a very keen photographer, Lord Healy. I asked if I could see his photographs he took inside Bilderberg, and he told me to F off. So he wouldn't do that. But he was basically free with me.
Did he ever say that they have the ability to control presidents, prime ministers, other people throughout this planet who are running governments?
What they did say to me was that there are times when a Bilderberg meeting will have impact on world affairs. And they gave me a couple of examples. One was Margaret Thatcher was kind of talent spotted by Bilderberg in the mid-70s. And apparently she did really badly, sat at the back like a church mouse. And then somebody told her to buck up. And so she gave a fantastic speech, apparently. And everybody was so impressed that they flew her over to America, and David Rockefeller drove around in a limousine and, you know, introduced her to all these important people. And the person, the Bilderberg who told me that, said, you know, well, is that a conspiracy or is that just the way things are done? And there were things like that. Sanctions against the Falkland Islands during the Falklands War, apparently, was an idea that began at Bilderberg and sort of spread back into the various different foreign policy departments of different countries.
So they have the ear, though, of leaders, don't they?
Oh, yes, goodness. I mean, no question. What I said, obviously Jim Tucker would say that they make Clinton president, they make Blair prime minister. The Bilderbergers say, no, they're just really good talent spotters. What they want to do is get the person they think might be the next prime minister into a room with them, and they can offer them wise words.
Yeah, very wise, like you will help us. How many Bilderberger members are there?
Well, there's different stratas, because there's the steering committee, and I think it's two from each country. So two Brits, two Americans, two Germans, and so on. And then they will get together and decide who to invite each year. And then there's the outer strata, which is like a kind of, you know, the people who just come in for that one meeting. And so the year I was chased away, you had the head of Monsanto there. You had Jonathan Porritt from Friends of the Earth. And I don't think those people, just the fact that they attended a Bilderberg meeting, doesn't make them Bilderbergers. So I think you need to...
No, that's true.
You need to differentiate. Right. But the steering committee is, you know, people like Kissinger, Rockefeller, Conrad Black, you know, head of newspapers all over the world, was a big Bilderberger.
Is it possible that there were other members of this organization that were even above these people? You just never saw them?
Well, we watched them all going in limousine. Well, taxis, actually, dusty taxis they all turned up in. No, I think that the guest list that they do send out as a press release is who is there attending the meetings. It's a powerful think tank from the kind of liberal center left, you know, with the exception of people like Rockefeller and Kissinger.
Why, though, in conspiracy theory, do people think of this organization, and of course it's the Illuminati also, yeah. Why do people think of them as...
Okay. Yeah, same guy. And I spent a year with Omar Bakri back in 97, filming a documentary about his life. Really, I just thought it was funny. I mean, at the time, don't now, but at the time I thought it was funny that here was a guy living among us who said he wanted to see the black flag of Islam flying over Downing Street. So I figured, you know, he lives down the road from me. He's going to need to use our symbols to destroy them. So I followed him around for 3 years. He was buying, you know, collection boxes for Hamas, and the only collection boxes they had were large plastic novelty Coca-Cola bottles and so on. And it was kind of like a carry-on movie, Omar's Jihad campaign.
Did he know you were following him?
Yeah. He didn't know I was Jewish, although he outed me.
And then during the middle part of that hour, we're going to bring in Alex Jones. He, too, infiltrated the Bohemian Grove as well. We'll get his take on some of these strange things that continue to go on our planet. Back in a moment on Coast to Coast AM. Our guest is John Ronson right here on Coast to Coast AM. John, you're also a best-selling author. Your book, Them, Adventures with Extremists. How did you get involved in this very strange type of research that you've been doing?
There was a guy living up the road from me called Sheikh Omar Bakri Mohammed, who's Britain's most notorious Islamic cleric. Well, they just kicked him out, actually. Called the 9/11 hijackers.
Okay, yeah, that was him. Same one. Okay.